Eu não vou falar em português porque já não vivo em Portugal há 18 anos e já não estou habituado. Sou do Porto, não sei se já tenho sotaque. Let's start with one question. Who built this room? Anyone knows? Arms up. Who built it? Nobody. Who owns it? Anyone? Nobody knows? Nobody knows who owns this room? Okay, there's like 1% of people. What about your home? Do you know who built it? Arms up. Okay. 45%? No, no, no. And who designed it? Who knows? Okay, 23.5%. If you own 10 buildings, do you think you have more power in the city? Who agrees? 12%. Is 2 enough? 2%. If you have power, do you think you can influence the design of the cities? Who agrees? Oh, it's like 70 or 80%. You think that was a democratic process? All right, like 10%. How can you decide upon the city if you do not understand it? You know the meaning of the word politics? Polis, city. Politics means the matters of the city. The reason I'm here is because I have been designing cities. I have designed over 50 buildings in 20 countries, in close connection with politicians and guys with big money, billionaires. And some things are not really working out really well, so we have to improve them. Let me explain you why. Let's take the citizens, right? Some of them are locals, some of them regional, and some of them are going to be the users of that building over there. You have the politicians, and then you have the guys with the money, the developers. And the guys like me, the architects, engineers, facilitators. These guys, the citizens, vote on the politicians. Those are always lobbying the politicians. But they also give the resources to designers. You go, here's the money, make it fly. So what we do, we check the market and see what can we build the most with the least, to make the most amount of profit for those guys there, the developers. So if we could, we would build just next door, 100 floors, 1 million square meters, and the size of the apartments would be so small to get the most amount of money for the developers. That's what they want. But luckily, we have rules. The Urban Planning Department sets rules, zoning laws, for example. You cannot build everything. We set the rules, they're strict, and they are very strict in most of the countries. These guys are nominated, yeah, by the politicians. Sometimes, in most of the countries, not all, even if everything goes well, we ask the local citizens, do you agree with this? Can we build that thing over there? Even if all the rules are good, do you agree? Because, you know, they might have not seen everything, every detail. So if they agree, bling, the house is done. Okay, so we have top-down decision-making, the politicians, and some bottom-up, the local citizens. So it's a good mix. We know these are corruptible. Everyone is. I am. Everyone has a price. And they lack also detail. They don't know all the details. That's expensive. To incorporate everyone, every citizen to be part of it is expensive, and they lack the oversight. They don't know everything. And that's the issue. That's not under public scrutiny. Meaning, we are not voting where our resources are being applied in the city. And we all know this is a scarce resource. 44% of global CO2 emissions are from the construction industry. That's double the amount of the transportation industry. So if you were worried about getting your flight to come here, Maybe you should be worried about buying the next house. And what about the building? If you built it, was it a good one? Well, was it good for society? Normally, how do you evaluate the buildings? How do you know it was a good one? You see a great photo in a magazine. Yeah? Well, it turns out that most of our buildings is done with cement that lasts only 30 years. Less than your mortgage. And what about democracy? How are we evaluating if it is a good process, if the political process is good? Well, representative democracy, which is the most established system we have, comes from the 12th century, from a king nearby, from Lyon, 17-year-old guy. A bit outdated system, probably. One thing is sure, one thing we know, we are not going to decrease on complexity. Cities are going to become more complex. That's the history of everything. We are more complex than a bear, than a cockroach. Cities are going to be more complex, but we have limited cognitive abilities. So we either give up and give hands to automated democracy. For example, the traffic control is already completely automatic. Or we find new ways to be part of the decision-making process. And that's what we're proposing. We are doing some research in Finland, where I'm now based, in Helsinki, called Architectural Democracy. And we are mapping the relationships between architecture and democracy, because it matters. Because like this, we can understand both better and our cities. Here's how it goes. In one side, we put the characteristics of architecture. It sounds difficult. Well, we just put the birth, the life, and the death of a building. And on the other side, we put the characteristics of democracy. The ability to speak freely. Being informed about what you speak. And then that people hear what you're speaking. If we crisscross them, there are questions that pop up. What construction design processes can improve social equality, civil rights, and liberties? Free speech, for example. The other way around, what kind of civil rights and liberties can promote a good construction design of a building? Tough questions. And so on, and so on, and so on, and so on. On this one, we have the factor time. And here we have social context. And then we have scale. Because when we ask you the questions, each one of you will answer with your biased experience. So if I ask any individual, he will know the details. But if I ask a group like Greenpeace, he will ask in a larger scale. So let me give you an example. How we are doing this. And why is this relevant? If we are framing this, if we find a method that makes us think better, right, in an easier way, we are limited in terms of cognitive limited abilities. We can find maybe the right question. And by doing the right question, likely we'll have a set of right solutions. And as a famous person used to say, if you think you have a solution, you're part of the problem. So there's a problem we know. Disneyfication. Who heard about this? All right, so I don't have to, well, maybe. Disneyland, all right? So what's happening in our cities? Especially in Portugal, it's massive, in Porto. And also I heard in Peniche is also suffering from that. We protect our buildings, heritage buildings. So we protect what? We protect mostly their facades. Not everything is protected. So it turns out what it's easier is we keep the facades and we take off everything inside and make it new. So it becomes a Disneyland. If you go to Porto, if you enter an old building, it looks old from outside and from inside, oh, so beautiful, new, everything is comfortable. And why is this happening? Why is this happening? Why people don't want the old park? It's beautiful. Well, remember this? Too many. So the same thing that was protecting us, the laws, protecting us from the greedy us, me, to make the most out of the least, is the same thing that is destroying us, destroying our heritage. So this is a problem. How we deal with this? Okay, so if we decrease the laws, we have another problem. So we have to find a balance. And if we continue waiting until the policies are updated, all the buildings are gone. Because our policies are slower than the market. So what we did is, well, why not if we could click on that building and open it up? Take off the facade. Take off exactly what they are protecting and show what's inside in the building and show the relationships happening there, the people with the stories, the heritage. And that's what we did. We went to those buildings. We can make photos, very simple, with your phone, using photogrammetry. And with that, you generate a 3D model out of that. Looking nowadays, this is a building in Porto, in Caldeireiros Street. You take off the facade and you see the building there. This is in collaboration with some research institutes, so we're using the latest technology. And then we mix with, for example, OpenStreetMaps, and we have an automatized system that everyone can show the insides of their houses just with a phone. No high tech. We create a platform. All right, so what information access promotes a good construction and design of a building? Well, we just propose that. We can see the inside of the building. So maybe we can preserve the building better and build it better. The right question, likely a good solution. Let's take another question over here. What recycling strategies and materials promotes participation? Another big problem is the emptiness. So many abandoned buildings out there. We are building everywhere. I just came from China yesterday, a city in Wuhan has 3,000 ongoing construction sites. If we stop building, the economy collapses. It's the thrive of our economy, is the construction of buildings. If we stop doing it, nothing else will work. And yet, of course, we have a lot of empty buildings. How many of you have seen this abandoned old factory and said to yourself, wouldn't it be great to turn it into a loft? With some friends and a coffee downstairs and but you still live there. In the shoebox, where your neighbor lives 20 years beside you, separated by a 20 centimeter wall. And you know better Brad Pitt than that guy. Loneliness. But the good news is that actually there is empty buildings, so we can do something about it. In China, it's 24%. In Europe, it's over 10%. The numbers are difficult to get. So we made this company called Gamified Co-Housing, turning empty buildings into co-working and co-housing economies. So how does this work? This is our pilot project in Finland. An old house, an old school, abandoned. So usually, it's very difficult to turn this back alive. Why? I explain it. Legislation, difficult, maybe owned by different people in the family. A big problem, for example, in Portugal. Bad location, who wants to go there? Or it's too expensive to do that. So we have to get rid of those problems by doing the minimalistic renovation approach. So we use lean construction methods and low budget technologies. Meaning we don't plan everything at the same time, we go step by step. Another point, we use co-working and co-housing. This is back in the old days, where you live and work in the same place. Right? The houses were optimized. Even if we have 10% of empty buildings, in overall, and if you work and you commute, every building is 50% of the time empty. But if you create an economy, there's an incentive for people to go there. Another thing we do constantly is to overplan things. We put walls everywhere, and we know things are going to change over time. So we should be more modular in our design. Of course, it doesn't sound good, and I know that very well. And as an architect, you always want to give a big plan, because like everything planned, yeah, here you go. Because then where you get the money? If you plan it a lot and it looks great, you get a lot of money. But if you say, I don't know, let's just leave it like that. It doesn't work. But fundamental is not even the physical side, it's the social side. The changes over time. So that's why we propose the gamification of the living. Like in a Sims game. The game mechanics is great in finding out what is the minimum amount of effort to do something, that you keep on doing it, and the maximum amount that you don't give up. That threshold. So if you have, for example, in this house, we have an several apartments and a shared space. A person who lives in that apartment pays it. Has his own privacy, pays the rent, everything normal. She or he doesn't have to do anything more than that. But they can. They have just beside them a shared space where they can do their own business, rent it out, or even do small tasks like cleaning the windows or sweeping the floor. And if they do so, they get money, they get credits, instead of hiring a company to do that. It works. We have been doing that. So what renovation strategies improve participation? There you go. We renovate a building, we can also improve participation. Like this, we still embed it in a business model that copes with reality with our system. We don't have to make a revolution. Revolutions were never good, you know that. Hot topic. We don't need changes. We need improvements. Changes happen all the time. Changes happen every time. So we need to cope with the changes that come to us. The kind of people we want to be is the kind of cities we should be designing. If we want to continue to have a profit-driven city, we should continue with the smart cities approach, where we optimize, where we want to be efficient everywhere. And that's what we become. But are we really efficient? Are we really efficient beings, or are the computers efficient? Are we going to be replaced by the computers? Likely, if we continue on this path. We cannot make rules in everything, otherwise we'll be tyrants. But we also cannot just let everything go, a chaos, because we'll become hopeless. We have to embrace the change and be masters of chaos. Thank you.